Now, let's discuss the first stage of labor. So in review of all of our stages of labor, let's remember that stage one starts from onset of labor until 10 centimeters dilated. Stage two is 10 centimeters dilated until the delivery of the infant. And stage three starts with delivery of the infant and ends with delivery of the placenta. So in stage one, we have contractions that are causing cervical change, and they're also causing the fetus to descend into the pelvis. We can further divide stage one into latent labor, which is onset of contractions until 4 centimeters dilated, and into the active phase. This is from 4 centimeters dilated to 10 centimeters dilated. Now, what's considered normal? For our primips, first-time moms, the latent labor can last 6 to 11 hours. For our multips, 4 to 8 hours. In the active phase, we expect the cervix to change 1.2 centimeters per hour for our first-time moms, and 1.5 centimeters per hour for our multiparous moms. So when we have an abnormal first stage labor, what causes that? Well, we think of the three P's: power, passenger, and pelvis. With power, we're talking about the strength of the contractions. Now, how do we measure the strength of the contractions? Typically in labor, our moms are going to have a monitor on that tells us from externally how often they are contracting. If we want to know how strong the contractions are, we place an intrauterine pressure catheter that measures something called the Montevideo Units. The Montevideo Units are a measurement that have taken over a 10-minute strip, looking at all of the contractions and measuring the area under the curve. We expect it to be 180 to 220 Montevideo Units to say the contractions are adequate. If those contractions are not adequate, we're going to start a medication called Pitocin. This is a synthetic form of oxytocin, and this makes the contraction stronger. Now, our next P is passenger. So what can go wrong with our passenger to make the first stage of labor abnormal? Well, we could have malpresentation of our passenger, such as a breech presentation, a face presentation, or a brow presentation that would prevent the passenger from coming down the pelvis, or the passenger could be having fetal heart rate issues. Now our next P is the pelvis. Now there's no way to determine what type of pelvis a patient has prior to labor, but just of note, there are four different types of pelvises. And depending on the type of pelvis, that can ease the delivery or it can make the delivery more difficult. So the gynecoid pelvis is one that allows the head to always rotate to occiput anterior, making vaginal delivery pretty easy. Anthropoid pelvis, more common in African American women, cause the fetal head to rotate to the occiput posterior position. While they can still have a vaginal delivery, sometimes that can be a little difficult, and sometimes it requires an operative vaginal delivery to get those last little maneuvers to have the fetal head go underneath the pubic symphysis. The platypaloid pelvis will cause the fetal head to be in a transverse position. If you remember from our previous lecture, we need that fetal head to be occiput anterior or occiput posterior so that only 9.5 centimeters of the fetal vertex is trying to pass through the pelvis. Remember that the fetal pelvis is largest at 10 centimeters at its largest point. A transverse presentation is not going to be able to be passed through the pelvis. And an android pelvis is more like a guy's pelvis, and that it's heart-shaped. And in this type of presentation, the fetal head has difficulty even engaging.